Is it still coming out? Are you sure I just wasn't while we were driving past, I was doing my checks? Copy.
Welcome to our live safari, coming to you from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains game reserves in the Sabi Sands in the great national park area of South Africa. And can you believe it? It rained. And then it stopped raining, just in time for us to go out on a drive, which I'm most thankful, because I have to say that the prospect of driving around in midwinter with drizzle dripping down my back, and I'm sure Dave feels the same, not entirely pleasant. But yes, good afternoon. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon, as you may have gathered, I have Dave once again on camera with me, and we're going to head out and see what wonderful things we can find for you on this somewhat damp and soggy game reserve, which of course is wonderful given the current drought situation we've been experiencing. Look, we didn't exactly have the great sort of monsoons of Africa. We had about probably a mil of rain, but it's enough to stave off the drought that is to come. If you have any questions on the wonders of the African bush or anything else, I suppose, but probably our expertise is best limited to the wonders of the African bush, you can send those through to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Brent is out with Liam on the other vehicle, perusing the joys and the wonders. I think for both of us, we have plans to stick fairly close to home. Across Cheetah Plains are going to be in store, just in case it does decide to deluge down upon our heads, at which point we will have to turn and scurry for home. I do have my blue poncho though, my incredibly well-fitted blue poncho that makes me look something like a sailboat. So if worse comes to worse, we will be able to at least get home somewhat in a dryish condition. Our cars are all beautifully wrapped up in their rain covers, just in time for the rain to have stopped. And while we head out and see what we can see, Brent has made good on what he said he was going to do this afternoon, and he has found some elephants.
I've been listening to these elephants the whole day from the house. I've heard them feeding down below, breaking branches, trumpeting, squealing. And so Liam and I decided to come have a look for them. And here they are. And my name is Brent, and welcome to a slightly damp Juma for the sunset safari. I have Liam, as I said, on camera with me. But look at this cool weather is prompting some amazing behavior from the young elephants at the back. Rolling around. Now, look at that. So, and there's another young Ellie taking a snooze behind, a slightly older one, sort of 10 or so years old. And you very rarely see that type of behavior in adults, but with youngsters and sub-adults, it is quite common. And that little guy is just having the best time. Rolling around in the nice, cool, damp ground. Safely under mom's belly, who's spraying dust, as you can see it falling down onto him. Here we go, little one. Just too sweet. And keep those massive frames well fed. Very nice, long, straight ivory on that cow. quite an old female. You can see the indentations on her head there. And it's one of the ways you can start seeing age in elephants, when their skin around their head starts to sag into some of the shapes on their skull. So she's probably over 40, 45, maybe even a little bit older. A big female. I'm just going to move forward a little bit so we can try and get more of those youngsters having a ball. How's that, Jim? There's a couple of them all under there. I can see one, two, four at least. Oh, there we go. Perfect. Mom's moves out the way. There's three, four. Possibly four. Look at this. This is just too cute. Now, elephants can be very, very playful, especially when they're still dependent on mom's milk. They don't have to worry too much about foraging and feeding. And of course, with the drought we're experiencing at the moment, you'll probably find the hours in a day that the females need to feed to keep producing milk is longer. So it can be a stressful time for elephants when it is very dry. But of course, those little guys haven't learnt to worry about that stuff yet. I wonder if this is part of that same massive herd we saw on the sunrise safari. And if you listen carefully, they are all around us. See how they're breaking branches? And sometimes it's amazing how quietly they can move. Just heard a branch break to the left of us, and there's an elephant sort of just about to appear out of the thickets on the left-hand side of the road and just approached us so silently. You see that darkness through there. Looks like it's gonna stop to feed in there. To see the ears. Now, we're talking about the age of elephants, and Richard Holmes is wondering, at what age do elephant cows stop breeding? Probably around 50, 55 or so, Richard. But they normally manage to raise about 6 or 7 babies through their life, and they have a very high success rate compared to a lot of animals out here in terms of rearing a baby to fruition. Generally, if there is going to be a mortality of a baby elephant, it happens very young, sort of a couple of days after birth normally. Now, in a very dry period like we're going through at the moment, we might find a few more of those mortalities. Also, sometimes the females might not be able to produce enough milk, and that'll also cause fatality. But in normal circumstances, they have a very, very, very high success rate in raising babies. Still one, that one there, lying and really rolling around in the dirt. Peaceful experience spending time with Eddie's like that. Look at that, there we go again. Nose planting itself right into the dirt. Yeah, I'm going to incredibly lucky at the moment with the amount of elephants. What do you think, Vim? If we go forward, we might get a better view.
Right.
Let's have a try.
This is wonderful. I love spending time with these ellies.
They are just too adorable.
The little ones are so playful.
The great rolling game is over. Herd looks like it's about to move on. The general direction they're heading towards is quarantine. So we might get them out in the open a bit later. But for now, they're going to move into the thick stuff. There's a big cow about to appear in front of us. Another cow with really long ivory. Just move forward a tiny bit. Just on the other side of this bush. Nice long ivory. Hello, madam. Oh, is that? They're talking. Those low rumbles can be heard by the elephants up to 20 kilometers away. And you can see there's her left tusk. She's left tusked. And generally, elephants will utilize one tusk more than the other for stripping bark, for cleaning grass or pulling out long bits of grass. So the one tusk wears down quite obviously in comparison to the others. Now, how quickly the tusk wears down is often very, very relative to where the elephants are. And you often get these in Kenya. You have elephants with those lovely, lovely, really long, really great-looking ivory, like around Amboseli and in the Maasai Mara. That's because of the two rainy seasons in the Mara, there's a plethora of grass to eat at all times. Whereas here in the bush, we don't have that access to grass. So you often find a lot more broken tusks, a lot more worn tusks. They have to use their tusks on trees and quite often even see them sometimes digging up tubers with them because of the nature of the bush here. So you don't always get sort of perfectly even and perfectly lovely tusks. What's going on behind us, Ben? I'm having a nap again. Slightly bigger one rolling around and go forward. I'm trying to get up. So even there we've got quite a young one there, and you see how it's got to rock its body to get up. And that's why you often find adults do not do that. It is a serious effort to get back up again. Sometimes they even get a little bit panicked as they get a bit older and then they try to stand up. The only time you really see an adult doing that is when there's a nice termite mound or fallen tree to lie against, so they're not all the way down on their sides. There we go. Managed to get up to the knees. A very cumbersome way to stand up, but oh, I was just playing. Oh, flopped around the other way. Let's go back a bit. Sure, look at that. Taking advantage of the nice cool ground, slightly damp. We had some drizzle during the day, nothing too heavy. I don't think it's gonna cause too much growth or greenery, but the elephants are really enjoying the cool weather. And the little one got a boot in the bottom from the one lying down. So the reason for this behavior, from what you can see, it just really looks like they're enjoying it. So having a nice roll, a little bit of playfulness, nice cool ground. That was a funny noise out of the trunk. Oh, look at that. That was... Yes, we can hear you. Very, very entertaining young Ellie there. You can see he's now completely covered in dirt. Which of course it does help with some of the flies and other creatures that tend to bite them. Quite often if we probably went to have a look once those elephants moved away from there, we'd find the odd tick on the ground. Almost, you do see these bonds between groups of young elephants, almost like a little gang, a little clique. They do sometimes pick on other elephants, but generally the mothers will be there to sort it out, making sure no one gets picked on too much. So Darlene in New Hampshire is wondering, do I think that the older males play a role in keeping the younger males in check? Definitely, Darlene, and there's been very noticeable cases where they've moved young male elephants into an area that where big male elephants are absent. What happens is their must cycles, their hormonal cycles become quite volatile, and they tend to attack a lot of things. And it seems with a big dominant male around, it suppresses the must in the younger males. So there is definitely an element of that they won't misbehave too much but from fear of retribution from the big males. But the Ellies are going to move off, so we're going to do the same. Hi, Gracie. Gracie is 8 years old, and Gracie says she thinks it's so fun when the elephants roll around on the ground. Do the big ones ever do it? Only very, very sometimes, Gracie. And normally, because they're so big, they'll find it very hard to get back up. So they'll normally find something to lie on to do it. Or the other time big elephants play like that and roll around is when they're swimming in the water. So that's when the big elephants do it. So they do it, but not nearly as often as the little ones. While we're moving on through here, we've also got a question from Lyle in Washington, who's wondering, do we see many birth defects or deformities, natural deformities from birth? You do see them occasionally, Lyle, but not too often. Normally, a lot of those sort of deformities and stuff will lead to that animal dying very young. But in elephants, one of the more common deformities you do see is multiple tusks. So the most, I've seen one with 3 tusks here, but the record is 7 individual tusks coming out of a single elephant. So that's probably one of the more common elephant birth defects. And then we did see an elephant that looked like it had been, its tail never developed while in utero. So it was born without a proper tail. So you do see them,
But they are relatively uncommon. If any major defect, it generally tends to be that animal dies very young and probably before we get the chance to see it properly. So Viam and I are sticking to our plan, which I think you heard over the Juma Dam cam by accident. Not sure how that happened. We're going to go do what we do every day and check the southern boundary for any sign of Queen Karula. Maybe with this cold and overcast rainy weather, the Queen has come back for a visitation. But in the meantime, let's go see what Jamie and Dave are up to on the other vehicle.
So, well, Brent drives along and double, triple checks the southern boundary to see if the wonderful Queen of Juma has decided to cross. I'm starting to feel, and Dave, I'm sure you must be feeling it as well, starting to feel a little bit jealous about all of these incredible elephant sightings that everybody's been having. I feel as though we need a really nice elephant sighting of our own. Don't you agree? Yes.
Yes.
Definitely. Didn't really give you an option there, though. So what we've decided to do is we've decided to head to Biffleshook Dam. I've actually come here because I want to go and have a look at that hippo that Sam was looking at yesterday afternoon. I was sort of hoping he might still be here. Fortunately, though, the water's looking very still, most undisturbed. In this case, Biffleshook Dam, still waters do not run all that deep. So a hippo will not be hiding too far beneath the surface. Oh, it's been very green. Oh, thoroughly unpleasant. Positively pea green in colour. Well, since we're here, and since we have the opportunity to stop, Georgianne from Illinois, I really hope that you are watching, because you sent through an answer to my question this morning. So this morning, we saw this incredible moth. Most beautiful pink colour with the transparent patches on its wings that I have never ever seen before. And of course there are so many different types and species of moth that it is impossible to know each and every one. So how on earth Georgianne managed to find out that it was a Bowers frother moth? Let's go for the Latin, let's do it. Amarilla Bowery. How you managed to find that, I do not know, but I'm very grateful. Thank you. I have learned something new. And of course, now that it's been one of those things that's come through in one of these live drives, I will never ever forget that. Just like my thin marbled lichen from months ago. It's the fantastic thing about this two-way interaction between ourselves and the viewer. So a Bowers frother moth is what that was. It's quite difficult to say that several times fast. A Bowers frother moth, Bowers frother moth. It's the frother moth part that gets you. Oh, no action at Biffleshook Dam. I don't suppose I'm that surprised, since it is rather cloudy and rainy. Not all that much happening here. And no sign of our hippo friend either. The reason I wanted to just go and have a look at him was just because he was displaying some interesting reactions to Sam's vehicle, and I'm sure partly because he was being disrupted and disturbed by the elephants that were cavorting in his swimming patch. I wanted to just go and have a look, see if we could figure out where he'd come from and if he was an old male. All right, we're going to go through a bit of a dip here, and there's a chance I'm going to lose your signal, so I'm just going to be quiet for the moment, but it'll be 2 seconds and then we'll be up the other side. Oh! Should be relatively all right. The reason I laughed earlier was every time I go underneath a tree and the antenna hits it, it's like when you pull a tree that just after the rain and you cover your friends with water droplets. That keeps happening to me every single time I go underneath one. But speaking of Sam, I know that many of you are concerned. He, I'm sure, will be absolutely fine. He was not feeling terribly well this morning, and so he has gone off to the doctor this afternoon. So we'll see what the doctor says, just because we don't want to take any chances. and we'll keep you updated, but I think chances are he could be back up and running and on the vehicle by tomorrow. No. I was also sort of hoping, because only 4 Nkuruma lionesses have been seen recently, sort of hoping that our lioness that was so close to giving birth might have decided to move out into the open after the rain just to dry off. But it looks as though that might have been wishful thinking. She doesn't seem to have appeared here. But we will keep you updated on Sam's state and how he's doing. I'm sure he'll be back with you very shortly, making you out on game drive. And I'll say thank you on his behalf just for all of your concern and well wishes. I know that they mean a great deal to him. Hey, let's check around here, see if we can't spot the Nkuruma lioness somewhere here. And then, failing that, I think we'll go. Since it might be a relatively quiet day, although that remains to be seen, don't forget to send through your questions at #SafariLive on Twitter or through email at questions@wildearth.it. Hopefully that should be showing up on your screen. Now, to remind you, just in case the sound of the voices don't quite get it through to you. Oh, face full of water. I suppose I deserved that. And then I think, failing any action at Buffelshoek Dam, I do want to go back to the hyena den. We got thoroughly torn away this morning by a kudu alarm calling frantically. First of all, I want to check out if there are any tracks in that area. But secondly, I do want to go and see if the cubs have come out, since just before we left, one of the females walked in with a massive buffalo leg for the cubs to play with. So it might be thoroughly entertaining, and it's nice and cool, so they should be out. We'll have a chance to go and watch their shenanigans. Doesn't look, though, like the rain is going to come pouring down again. Sort of slight, ever so slight patches of blue every now and again appearing in the sky. Now, Dinga, you were wondering on the subject of our rain, how much rain fell upon Juma. As I said earlier, it wasn't really so much a monsoon as just a dribble of water, but we are thankful, of course, for every single drop. The answer, if I had to guess, is probably about a milliliter or so, if not even less. Now, usually we get emails that are automatically generated from the weather station that give us very accurate reports of just how much rain has fallen. So I'll have a look and see, but I would guess that it was around about a mil, maybe 2 if we're really lucky, we're feeling optimistic. And this is what most of the animals are doing on this rainy afternoon, hiding in the dense vegetation and feeling a little bit chilly and a little bit damp and soggy and rather sorry for themselves. Especially as a male impala who clearly, judging by his current bachelor state, may or may not be doing terribly well in the rutting season that has started. And we see more and more of these lone male impala. Now, he's either not managed to gather a harem yet, or he did and exhausted himself in his efforts to keep them from mating with other males. Yes, we're talking about you and your social life. And we see quite a few of them. They've lost a lot of condition, all looking much thinner than when we first went into the rutting season. And again, being out in the bush, the more you stop and look, the more you see. And that is particularly applicable to an animal called a kudu. They have the most amazing, and I'm gonna show Dave where it is. And I'll show you just how well those white stripes that act as disruptive colouring really work to hide their shapes. Isn't that incredible? I mean, we're not far away from that animal at all, but it took me a good few moments of watching the impala before I even realized that she was there. Every now and again, you get the slightest twitch of an ear. Hey, let's go closer now that you've got an idea. But I did just want to... Oh, there's two. The old saying goes, the more kudu you look for, the more you see, once you've spotted one. But yes, those sides striped help to hide the animal. I have a question for you guys. Okay, so you all know, our regular viewers all know why some female antelope have horns and some don't. I have a different question for you. And the answer is not to do with size. Why do you think it's a theory? Okay, so I'm looking for sort of the closest match to a theory that I buy into. Most of you have seen the spectacular male kudu's horns. Huge spiraling things. The same goes for the impala. They've got relatively interesting looking horns. Waterbuck, nyala, bushbuck even. So why is it that some antelope males have these spectacular heads of horns, whilst others, like the steenbok and the daker, only have tiny little spears? And it's very much to do with what the males use their horns... Ooh, that may be giving it away a little bit, but what the males use their horns for. The answer's a little bit more tricky than the usual story about why female antelope in these areas don't necessarily have horns and other species do. But if you are joining us for the first time, or this is one of your first live safaris, just to explain what I mean, this is a female kudu. Absolutely beautiful, graceful antelope, one of the largest that you will find in this area. And the males have enormous spiraling horns that reach up out of their heads, as the females do not. And yet, with something like a blue wildebeest, both the males and the females have horns. And that's because of the differences in habitat and the fact that in kudu, a horn is actually more of a disadvantage for a female than an advantage. They rely on their cryptic colouring and their ability to disappear and hide in thick vegetation. Whereas the males need to retain them because they still need to fight for access to the females. But with blue wildebeest, much more open vegetation, much more open habitats. Thus, they actually need their horns to defend themselves from attack from predators. And they really are truly beautiful animals, a kudu. Huge radar dish ears that can move independently of each other. And those big sideways facing eyes. All the better to spot a predator with. Hello, Olinda. It's so wonderful to have you on board. Olinda is a new viewer who has just stumbled upon us by accident. And Olinda would like to know what time these live streams are. Well, I have fantastic news for you. We are on every day, twice a day, come wind, rain or shine, although not too heavy rain because that sort of interferes with our equipment, but come wind, rain and mild drizzle, we will be out and about. Central African time in our winters, we start at the moment at 6 o'clock Central African time in the morning for 3 hours until 9 o'clock, and then from 3 o'clock in the afternoon, so 1500 to 1800 in the evening. That's all Central African time. Obviously, Olinda, I don't know exactly where you are in the world, so I cannot tell you what particular time it would be in your time zones. I'm also quite useless when it comes to these things called time zones. You'll have to forgive me, but hopefully you'll be able to work it out from there. And it's wonderful to have you on board. I hope you enjoy that. Enjoy what you've been seeing so far. Our little... So that kudu that just walked past, that young kudu, probably is the youngster of this female that's hiding out behind the trees. And the rate that these animals grow, that could well be one of the babies that we saw in this area just after they were born at the beginning of the year. There was one particular sighting that was absolutely incredible, very close to where we are now, where whilst we weren't fortunate enough to witness the birth, we did see the kudu calf as it was just a few hours old, still damp, and with its umbilical cord still attached and little legs wobbling away. It is amazing to see how much they have grown. And just like that, they have melted away. And it's very difficult for you all to get a sense of perspective and a sense of scale when you watch through the eyes of the camera. Oh, hello. Sorry, change of tack. The entire time we've been sitting here talking about males and talking about their horns on the top of their head, we have been closely watched. I don't know if you can see there, Dave. In between, you got him. Ah, the secret of kudu. In this case, a big bull. Oh, not that big. Looks, could be a fair-sized. He's been watching us the whole time. Now, hopefully, he's going to move across the road and towards the females, just so I can show you what I mean about the comparison between a male and a female. He's not that far away from us, and yet he has completely disappeared. Let's try shuffling forward. Maybe we can get a bit closer and get a clearer view of him. And then I can carry on with what I was going to say about scale. Kudu everywhere. A young female. Hello, girl. What are you up to? Shem, she's going to get a fright. Yep, there she goes. Immediately, that little white tail going up in alarm. Recently, I have seen male kudu like the one I'm about to show you, hopefully, fingers crossed. I've seen male kudu fighting over a female that's come into estrus. But kudu, unlike impala, do not have a set breeding season and therefore do not have a set rutting period. Now, Tom, who is a 14-year-old viewer, oh, here we go. Sorry. Oh. Hello, boy. We just want a brief view of you. You are so very beautiful. He's going to dash across the road in front of us. It's all right, boy. Gentle snort. There we go. Those beautiful curved horns. Look at that big, thick, shaggy neck compared to the females. All the better for holding up the weight of those horns that are solid bone. Sorry, Ben. It was Ben, not Tom. Every now and again my brain misfires. You wanted to know if impala were the only animal that has a rut, or the only antelope that has a rutting period. And the answer is no, but actually there's very few antelope that do have such a set rutting period. There he goes. Such beautiful, graceful animals. The other main antelope that has a rutting season and at exactly the same time as the impala is the wildebeest, but it doesn't extend for quite as long. So the blue wildebeest then has a rutting period around the same time. Warthogs, whilst not an antelope, also have a rutting period. And then for most of the antelope, because they have very similar gestation periods, between sort of 6 to 8 to 9 months, and for buffalo slightly longer, it'll be 11. For all of those animals, they might not have a set breeding period, but the best time to have a baby is in our summer, because there's lots of rain, therefore lots of food, better chance of survival. So for most of the animals, even though they don't have a set rutting period, the females go into estrus at any point in time, is usually a peak. That was interesting. He's horn thrashing. No, he obviously is trying to impress the lady. Let's roll forward, trying... Oh, boy. Okay, fair enough. I just heard this crunching thud. I didn't even realize he was still there. Kudu and Inyala do that. And Impala stick their heads into bushes and thrash it around because nothing says manly to a female antelope like destroying a small defenseless bush. There is, of course, it's a show of strength, a show of good genetics to pass on to their offspring. Now, there's a lot more mating for the antelope in this around this period, just because it's better to have a peak season in our summer. But Nyala and Kudu, generally you'll find babies at almost any time of the year. I like this archway. Whoa, here we go. A little bit about what your thoughts are as to, and I'm going to open it up to a discussion rather than a quiz. I think a quiz is a little bit unfair because, of course, we'll never really know the exact answer. And I'll tell you my theory and what I believe. And Aaron Hallis has come up with a very good answer as to why, with little antelope, a big set of horns could impede their feeding, their grazing, or their browsing. And you're in essence absolutely correct. That's why the females of those species don't have horns, because they would be, although that being said, now we're going into complications because occasionally you do get female dacre with horns. But it could in a way impede their ability to dash off into the vegetation. But I'm looking for something that requires a little bit of background into the difference between the lifestyles, let's put it that way, of a dacre and a steenbok versus the kudu, impala and nyala, the different antelope of the world. I'm going to clarify something. When I'm talking about the horns, I'm not just talking size, although the little antelope, their horns are disproportionately smaller. I'm also talking about flashiness, if we could call it that. Because a kudu, I mean, you can't help but describe a kudu as being a little bit flashy. Those horns are a little bit flashy. I mean, in terms of if you wanted a fighting weapon, you wouldn't have a curved sword or anything like that. But that's not the purpose of a kudu's horns. 95% of their job is in intimidation, not in the actual physical act of fighting. And in fact, the curvedness of those horns, kudu very often get hooked and stuck together. And they can die in that way. It's not really the most beautifully designed method of fighting. So whilst Aaron, your answer is not wrong at all. This is a very good answer, but it's not quite what I'm going for. There's another reason as to why it is they have that reproductive strategy and approach. Sorry, I just want to go back and check a track quickly. And amongst all of the buffalo that have come wandering through before the rain. Now, Hanalee, you've also come up with a perfectly good solution to our question, and that is the fact that the smaller antelope use it in a stabbing motion, whilst the larger ones are more about wrestling and a show of physical strength. Very, very valid observation. That is how we've seen them fight. But there's a slightly different answer, because you hardly ever see dacre or steenbok males fighting each other. Hello, little thing. I didn't think we would still be getting them coming out. I thought it was a little bit too late in the season, so this is a really exciting find. This is a giant land snail, and this is a small giant land snail. Not quite living up to the expectations of its name. I'll hop out so you get a sense of scale. just to get an idea of just how big he is, a bit large enough. You only really see them in summer after rain, so this could well be the last giant land snail that we see for the next few months. But here he is in comparison to my hand. Hello. Sorry. Don't mean to block you. You keep going. And they're actually relatively uncommon, very slow movers. Oh, let me move my hand out of his way. We had a slight collision there. Fantastically retractable eyes on the end of those stalks. Incredible animals with their long muscular foot. Now, I don't know if this is if I should call him sir or madam. And the reason behind that, of course, is that giant land snails, due to their life cycle and the slowness of the way that they move and the relatively small numbers of them, they actually have both male and female reproductive parts. So what that means is that when one lucky land snail finds another lucky land snail, they can fertilize each other, essentially increasing the number of offspring by two, double the effectiveness of the mating process. And for giant land snails, the genetic value is not lost because you've still got the sharing of the genetics there. They are great scavengers of carcasses and bones and other such things. This is still quite a young one. Squeeze past you here, buddy. Better hurry things along. Wonderful. That really could be the last one that we see of the year. There we go. Robin and Gail. Robin and Gail, who are on the same page as I am in our explanation behind horn sizes and the flashiness of horns. You are absolutely right. Smaller antelope are monogamous, and they pair up monogamously for their entire life, for the duration of their lives. They don't need to fight nearly as often for mating potential, whereas for kudu, nyala, impala, all of those animals are, they reproduce with lots of different females, and they aim to reproduce with as many different females as they can. And the females are not patient. They will go with the best male they can find. And that is why waterbuck, nyala, kudu, impala, all of those antelope have the beautifully curved, in some way flashy, showy horns that we see. So that's my take on it. That's why I feel as though that's how the animals have been designed through the evolution of hundreds of thousands of years. You don't have to agree with me, of course, but you guys, that's exactly where I was going. So very well done. Including a little bit of the animal's background, a little bit of knowledge on their life cycles and the way in which they live their lives. Now, of course, we've just got to find you one. Since I feel as though it would really complete the story nicely if we could find a pair of Steenbok nestling happily together. As that buffalo, unfortunately that buffalo disappeared. Jen, you're absolutely right. Sorry, I'm going to stop here because I just want to show you. Sorry, Jen, I'll be with you in a moment, actually. Let's just stop since we are here. What makes you think a herd of buffalo has moved through this area? It's just torn up ground and buffalo dung absolutely everywhere. This is what happens when 1,000+ buffalo move through. And they do hoof action like this, plus the additional natural fertilizers in the form of their dung, actually does tremendous good to the area out here. And we've spoken a lot about this before, about the way in which grasses have evolved with with the action of animals. So grazing and hoof action are actually essential in the life cycles and keeping grass healthy. Too many animals and you've got overgrazing, too little and you actually get undergrazing. And don't you just find it mind-boggling that the animals and the environment have actually figured that balance out. They've come to, it's just like that extract that I was reading from the Stevenson Hamilton book that I got from my granddad, about the fact that man actually has no idea. We are learning, but really nature in general is best left to its own devices to sort things out. But yeah, sorry, back to Jen and the answer to our little antelope question. You've pointed out that Nyala, Kudu, Impala, Waterbuck all herd animals, whereas the dwarf antelope species, the cephalofine family, Dacre, Steenbok, they're all territorial. And that kind of plays into similar to what I was saying, yes, because it comes down to they're territorial because they have their mate with them. They don't have to move around looking for mating opportunities. And thus you have the lack of necessity to have nice, flashy, showy horns. Sorry, I need to stop and put my jacket on because I'm about to get hypothermic. Now let's have a look at the sunny weather for a moment, shall we? This really glorious afternoon. Sorry, everybody. I'm built sort of something similar to a dwarf mongoose. I don't enjoy being cold. Can hear the wind howling. Might even mean more rain is on its way. Well, with that prospect in mind, let us find out exactly what Brent has been up to whilst he's been wandering about the bush on foot.
So, I'm busy being cold, but while being cold, Viam and I are checking an area that could possibly hold shadow. So, the last place she was seen was going into this property to the left. So, we're just checking our boundary, just for that slight hope, that slight chance she might have come back into Arethusa. But unfortunately, doesn't look like it. We're nearly at the end of the boundary. I'd like to pop in and come out at the southern end of the Arethusa airstrip. So we could look for some jackal while we're there and see what else might be out in the open in this windy weather. And unfortunately, this is the end of the road for us. That road, at least we've still got this road. Just making sure nothing's snuck on. It's a very unusual weather for this time of the year. General rule, it never rains during winter, but every year without fail you get at least one rain during the winter. So we're coming out to the southern end of the Arethusa airstrip. Wolfgang. Wolfgang would like to know what happens if two separate female leopards with cubs happen to come across each other. Well, Wolfgang, it probably wouldn't be a good thing. They would fight, and the cubs might escape in that pandemonium of fighting, but there is a possibility, especially if one female is bigger or more dominant than the other, that it could be the end for the cubs as well. Incredible. Unspotted Viam. You can see the buffalo weavers are none too happy.
from now, sometimes secretary birds might be building a nest on top of the buffalo weaver's nest. But I don't think so in this case. Now, you can see why the buffalo weavers need to build that impenetrable wall of thorns when you've got creatures like this about trying to get at the nest. Not an ideal day if you're a secretary bird, for hunting at least. A lot of a secretary bird's favorite things like warm weather. Snakes and snakes and lizards and other things are very, very fond of warm weather, and that's a secretary bird's favorite food. Might just be resting up there to get away from the cold. Maybe just resting there to get off the ground, feel a bit more safe. They are exquisite birds. Definitely the tallest bird of prey we get here. Okay, well, look at this beautiful secretary bird. And if you want to know anything more about the secretary bird that I might not have mentioned, pop us an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Now, from the tallest raptor we get here to the tallest living land mammal, and they're directly opposite each other. There's a vehicle coming through. Oh, sorry, Ryan's shouting at me on the radio. Sorry, go again, Ryan.
Yeah, dude, sorry, I've got a jig over here. I'm already late to get back to the car.
No problem. Are there any updates?
I've just come back from the east, so I'm not sure.
Lovely, thanks. Okay, so we've got the one tall animal there, and then a second tall animal over there. Oh, she's flown. Sorry, this would have been absolutely bombarded by the lapwings. She's gonna land. Okay, let's go have a closer look. A male giraffe grazing there, unfortunately just out of our traverse area as well though. There he is. So the tallest bird, or the tallest flying bird, and the tallest mammal. Down here somewhere, these short worries. Jackal may be sleeping up in one of these bushes. Can you see the secretary bird? Where has it gone? Landed around here somewhere. A bit deeper into the valley. But there we go, that's another reason we've been coming to the Arethusa airstrip, is to actually get a really good view of the secretary bird. And that's definitely the best view I've had since I've been at Safari Live. Searching. There's not much happening out here on the Arethusa airstrip this morning, and this evening, apart from that secretary bird.
Nope. And from what I can hear on the radio, there's no updates on Arethusa. So I think we might sneak back towards Juma, maybe head right up towards Sydney's. Maybe those two young male lions pop out. Hi, Emily from England. Emily would like to know, does the cold affect the animals in any way? A slightly cooler day, as we saw the elephants at the beginning of the safari were really enjoying that. Most of the animals are designed to be able to take a certain amount of cold. But the only thing you will really see is certain of the antelope species, they puff their hair up. And what happens is a layer of air gets stuck between the hair and their body, creating a nice warm insulated blanket around them. And the cats are generally more mobile when it's cool. Or the predators, generally more mobile when it's cool. So you've got a better chance of maybe bumping a leopard walking around a bit earlier than it might if it was a hot day. Thelma's asked, how many chicks does a secretary bird raise, and do they have a specific breeding season? Well, if I remember correctly, I think they've got two or three chicks. As for a breeding season, I might be incorrect, but I think it is the summer months, but I will double check that for you, Thelma. I haven't seen a secretary bird in a relatively long time. Trying to get my so Jean's wondering, was that the secretary bird's nest or of another bird? It wasn't. It was the nest of red-billed buffalo weavers, a communal nesting bird species. So unfortunately, not the secretary bird's nest. I think these are the same pair that nest further south from here on along the Losey. I can't remember where the secretary bird amongst the bird of prey. But just a reminder to everyone that we will be doing a school drive, but it'll only be starting at 4:30. Here we go. So I'm in Nyala moving out into the open. Pretty little one, little boy there as well. So, secretary birds are monogamous, so they mate for life, and they have a possibility of having massive home ranges of 20 to 230 kilometers squared. But it's normally around 50 or 60. Now I just wanted to see when their breeding season was. Okay, here we go. Year round. So they don't have a specific breeding season. They'll nest any time of the year. And they said, yeah, one to three eggs. Oops, sorry. You can see. Oof, it looks like they really don't like walking on the tarmac, not used to it yet. And they also don't like being caught in the open ground. Now there's impala snorting around, giving them a fright. But they want to get to the edge of the tree line, the bushes. They'll feel a bit safer there.
And here goes that impala is about to run behind them. Snort, snort, snort.
So funny, they really looked uncomfortable walking across the tarmac of the Arethusa Airstrip.
Now that's interesting.
How brave am I feeling, VM? Am I feeling brave?
You stick your head down there.
I'm going to stick my head down there. It looks like something's been going in there. It looks like possibly a warthog, but I'm going to stay a little bit further away when I check. VM has already got an evil grin on his face, hoping to see me jumping or squirming. But I want to check. Sometimes you get things like white-tailed mongoose and civet that also utilize these things. It'll be good to know. I'm going to start from a bit further away here. It's a very big spider's nest. VM, do you have a torch?
Yes.
You do?
Yeah, bro.
I'm just going to borrow VM's torch before I stick my head a bit closer. But if there is something like a civet or white-tailed mongoose there, it'll be quite good to know that they are utilizing this pipe. So it definitely looks like a warthog's been using it as a lie-up. Now, it's not a good place to lie if you're a warthog. A leopard can definitely scrag you out of there. Okay, well, so far, nothing in there. No mongoose or civets or anything interesting. But always worth having a look in these little things. And notice if you ever do want to look down a hole where there's possibly an animal, don't go like this. And start looking, that's one way to get hurt. Always try to give yourself a bit of distance, because if there is an animal in there, could get a fright, and you want to let it have an escape route that's not through you. It looks like just the warthog's been resting there. So Finn, who's 8 years old, would like to know, are secretary birds like ostriches? They are not at all, Finn. A secretary bird is a meat eater, so he likes to eat snakes and lizards and things. Whereas an ostrich is more of a grazer, so it eats seeds and fruits and grass. And so very, very different. Ostrich is much bigger. A secretary bird only weighs around 10 to 15 pounds. An ostrich can weigh over 100 pounds, so very, very different. But while we continue through here to see what we can see, let's see what Jamie's up to back on Juma.
Wouldn't it be absolutely wonderful if those secretary birds do decide to nest on the Arethusa airstrip? That'll be something different and exciting for all of us. I still haven't seen them yet. I haven't seen a secretary bird on since I've started working for Wild Earth in this area. So that's going to be tremendously entertaining if it does happen. Get to see them on a regular basis. Failing any action at Buffleshook Dam, I've decided to return to the alarm call area. There's a really lovely group of hoopoe there. Let's try going forward. I think they're gonna fly away. Don't fly, don't fly, don't fly. Please don't fly, please don't fly, please don't fly. Thank you. It's one of my favorite birds. Just in terms of their colouring. And of course, then we've got the bright, the bright contrasting colours of the starling. The African hoopoe. In the process of cleaning his bill, or her bill, free from any mud that he might have picked up whilst probing the dirt, and those beaks of theirs are incredibly sensitive. Oh, beep, beep, beep. Your mouse bird's calling. They've got really specialized nerve cells on the ends of those beaks, which means that they can pick up and detect any kind of movement in the ground below them. Go having a jolly good clean. And then they stab down and they pick out any worms that might be moving beneath the surface of the soil. And I think we've just caught the end of a bird feeding party. A bird feeding party is basically where lots of species gather together. Again, just the idea of safety in numbers more than anything else. They all gather together. It's different species that all utilize different types of food. They're not terribly in competition. Oh, here we've got a wonderful scene in front of us. Dave, can you see that crested barbet, that there's two of them? I don't know if they're just behind your gwarri bush or they're trilling. Can you see him there? He's sitting on the edge. Where is he? Oh, I think that the tree is just... Oh, there he is. There he is. Just to the right of your screen. Okay, he's now in the center. There we go. Perfect. Thank you. Now keep watching, because this is actually a juvenile crested barbet trilling away happily. I wondered why the trill sounded so strange, but it's a baby. A little fluffed up baby that hasn't quite got its full adult colouring yet. It's also feeling a bit chilly in this breezy afternoon. Now, if we keep watching, hopefully Mom is going to come back, or Dad, or indeed an older sibling, since they are cooperative breeders. The offspring of a previous generation will stick around and help out Mom and Dad with the raising of the next set of chicks. Oh, hopefully, I've just seen Mom fly in and feed it and then fly off again. And hopefully that's gonna happen once again. I can hear one of the crested barbets trilling off to my left somewhere. I could well return at any point. It's that grrrr sound that you might be able to hear. I'll be quiet for a moment just so you can listen. And the crested barbet very politely went quiet there as well. Come on, little one. Get it bobbing up and down on the branch. You see how much shorter the tail of a juvenile crested barbet is compared to that of an adult? They're not usually that round, though. This is just because it's cold and it's puffed up. Your parents are getting further and further away, buddy. I can hear them calling quite a distance now. We need to go and catch up. Now, the trill of the crested barbet is maintained for far longer than a breathful of air. That's because they practice what a lot of wind instrument players can do, especially, of course, the famous didgeridoo players. They can circular breathe. So they can inhale through one side and exhale out the other, which allows them to maintain that trill for an extended period of time. Oh dear, somebody appears to have a full belly. There's no sign of the adults returning once again. Come on. Oh, yes, no. Nope. Oh well, you have to take my word for it then. We'll see if we can't get a little bit closer. Get a nicer view. Much, much smaller than an adult crested barbet is. Once rescued a crested barbet out of a swimming pool in the house in Johannesburg where my parents live when I was a little girl. I paid quite a savage price for that. Yeah, didn't take kindly to being rescued and sliced open my finger. Those bills are exceptionally powerful and capable of essentially fulfilling their purpose, which is tearing into the hard exoskeletons of insects. The other bird I would love to get on camera and that we don't often get to see is the black-collared barbet. Very similar size to the crested, but with completely different colouring, but still with that black collar around the throat. He's actually quite cute, so tiny compared to an adult crested barbet. A beautiful vast array of black, yellow and red. I think your parents have gone with one. Apparently lots and lots of you taking screenshots. I'm really glad. Here's a lovely view of... We don't often get to see a baby crested barbet. They usually inhabit or nest in the holes in trees, hollowed out areas, and they can, like, it's not something that we think about, but with those powerful bills, they are actually capable of excavating their own holes in a tree. Okay, well, let's leave our chilly puffed up little barbet to wait for Mom and Dad to come and add to its meal. And we'll carry on and see what else we can find. Now this morning, we had the most quite a strange incident where I left the hyena den at a very rapid pace because I could hear kudu barking close to where we were. We found the kudu that was alarm calling, and a kudu is a very deep, very powerful, far carrying, it's the loudest bark of any antelope. And it is a bark, I mean it does go bah. And I don't know what she was barking at, and despite absolute best efforts, I could not find a single track of a predator around her. And I couldn't figure out what it was that had upset her so terribly. But we did find her baby, and I strongly suspect it was hers, quite far away from where she was. And it made me wonder whether or not we had arrived just missed a hunt, an attempted hunt, by some kind of predator. But as to which predator it was, I honestly have absolutely no idea. Okay, speaking about kudus and kudu babies, Emily, watching in England from where I have just returned, I hope the weather's slightly better than it was when I left, you were wondering about how many kudu babies a female will have in her lifetime. Sure, okay, let's think about this for a second. Kudu will reach sexual maturity probably at about a year and a half to two. And she'll have a baby at around a year and a half interval. And a kudu will usually can live up to 15 in the wild, but let's say her reproductive years are probably about 10. So she could maybe raise probably the average would be about 3 to 4, but maybe even up to 5 babies in her lifetime. That's very rough. Emily, that's kind of guesswork. It's kind of estimating based on what I know about kudu. But that seems to be about right. And then of course if she does lose a calf, and she'll come back into estrus quickly. So I'm thinking purely calves that have been raised to adulthood, because she could end up with the mortality rate for a kudu calf. Oh wow. Hello, son. With the mortality rate for kudu calves, she could actually have more than 4 or 5. They just don't all survive to adulthood. That would be my guess, if I had to give you a rough estimate as to the average number of babies that a kudu will have throughout her lifetime. Let's go look at that lovely giraffe in this afternoon light. It's so beautiful. It's like it's all cleared up. Everything is fresh and clean. The earth smells like petrichor. Love that word. And I know James loves that word. It's his favorite word. It's a beautiful afternoon. And we've got a lovely animal to share it with. Oh, girl. Looks like we've got a relatively mature giraffe female. Oh, hello, there's number two coming to see what all the fuss is about and what her friend is looking at. Oh, I say her friend. I think that the giraffe on the right is a young male. It's hard to tell when they are young, but it looks as though the ossicones, or the horns on the top of the giraffe's head, are a little bit thicker on the one than the one on the left. Yep, no, that's definitely a young male at the back there. So a subadult male and a female. It may or may not be his mother, not necessarily. They can associate with their moms for quite an extended period of time. But once they do leave home as an animal that is relatively gregarious by nature, but not in a fixed sense, they're quite happy to associate with strangers for a while. They are beautiful in this light. He seems to have accepted our presence far more readily than she has. She's keeping a very close eye on us. Lovely dark female. Generally, with giraffe, they do darken with age. But again, you just get some lighter coloured individuals and some darker coloured individuals. I'm just going to sit quietly for a moment because I've just heard an African green pigeon. And I'm hoping that you'll be able to hear the call. The reason I say that is because it sounds like, somebody once told me it sounds like Tarzan, an old-fashioned Tarzan movie, swinging through the trees. So I'm just going to see if we can't hear it. Or is this going to be like our crested barbet? Nope. Okay. I'll show you the green pigeons after we leave these giraffe. This is exactly where we saw the baboons earlier, by the way. So the giraffe also enjoying the guari berry boon that is currently occurring. Oh, and we have number three strolling in to join the group. Another female looking at us intently. And it's actually really nice because usually when we see male and female giraffe, it's usually a much larger bull that we see where the difference is clearly identifiable between a male and a female. We don't always get the opportunity to view a young male and a female of the same size next to each other, but it really gives you a good comparison. Oh, sure, all right. Budge up, buddy. It was quite aggressive from that female. But it does give you a nice comparison opportunity, except now he's hidden his head behind the bushes. But you can see, even when he does walk out again, just have a look at how much thicker his neck is, even though he is shorter than the two females. And then how much broader his head is as well. So even though he's a young male, he's younger than these two females, he's already starting to develop the characteristics of a mature giraffe bull. Oh, it's a lovely mature cow, that one. Nice and dark. Just to clarify, for us here in South Africa, this is giraffes in the afternoon light. It is going into our evening time now. So is the afternoon show, the sunset safari. We are looking towards the west and we've got giraffe highlighted by beautiful afternoon light. I'm not sure if I accidentally said morning light by mistake, as is entirely possible. The way that my speech patterns today have been going. I also have a tendency to call our drives the sunshine safaris instead of the sunrise or the sunset safaris. So, you know, it might well have been my mistake. But yes, it is evening time for those of you who are watching and just wondering about the time in South Africa. I remember once one of the funniest... I'm going to figure out what movement was that I just saw. One of the funniest comments we ever got through on YouTube was a comment from one of the viewers to say, "We've caught them out, it's not live, they're lying to us," because she started driving in the dark and now it's light. Obviously not quite realizing exactly how mornings work. Here's a nice giraffe track, just because we've got it in this afternoon light. And I know some of you are working on scrapbooks of tracks. Now, if I remember correctly, Dave, when we did our tracking assessment, most things were giraffe tracks to you.
That's quite right.
I mean, civets, lions, everything was a giraffe. So I'm looking at those tracks that are actually a giraffe. I don't know if you can see them there. I can actually hop out just to show you. But this is for... There you go. Perfect. Yeah, keep going. In the middle there. Perfect. This is for those of you building up a scrapbook, and you can't build up a scrapbook of tracks if you don't have a scale. So you'll have to make do with my hand, since I don't have any other implement. My Leatherman's gone walkabout. Sorry, distraction. Oh, it's a hyena track. Thought it was a leopard track. Here we go. Oh no. That's going to put you in the shade. A small giraffe track to add to your tracking screenshot scrapbook. It was nicely alliterative. Just to give you a sense of scale. This is quite a small giraffe. A large adult giraffe track would probably be, now I'm going to draw on it, so I hope you've all got your screenshots, would probably be about that size, a bit longer. I've messed it up, I'm sorry, there you go. That would be a normal adult giraffe track size of a bull. Scale. Okay. The giraffe are looking at me like I'm completely mad. I better get back in the car, I don't want to scare them away. Didn't realize that they were coming back this way. Giraffe do have, I mean, I'm sure I'm imagining it. Obviously they don't, but they do seem to occasionally give you such a judgmental look when you're doing something silly. And no animal can stare quite like a giraffe. Debra, our armchair traveller. You're wondering, well, apparently James has said to you that if you are, that a giraffe is curious enough that if you were to lie on the ground, they might come and investigate you out of curiosity. You wanted to know what my thoughts are on that. I think that is entirely possible. I have never tried it, and I'm not sure that now would be the best time in which to do so. Just due to limited time, plus the damp ground, actually, is one of the things that I'm considering in this thought process. But I entirely agree with James. I believe that that is possible. I've heard of it happening. I've never personally tried it, but I'll tell you what, I will. Oh, we appear to have a slight panic happening. What is this? This female's doing strange things. She's bucking and kicking and cantering. What's going on, girl? And is a giraffe, Debra, it is a giraffe defense mechanism to stand and stare. That being said, I actually think that they're quite intelligent animals in their own way. And I do believe that they have that level of curiosity. I've had it happen with buffalo before, where they've been curious enough, because when you're lying down, you no longer take on that bipedal human form. What are you doing? Ah, I see. Young males feeling the effects of teenage hormones, I think, a little bit. But that was more playful than anything else. Oh! She's not terribly impressed with him. She seems to be acting out as well. I'm glad to hear it, James. James has said thank you. And he's adding collections to his scrapbook of different tracks. That's an absolute pleasure. I feel as though it was quite necessary, since I failed to find you a mongoose track, and I think I actually forgot to find you a giraffe track as well at one point. So there you go. I have provided one for you to add to your tracking scrapbook. We usually encourage viewers, we're not going to do the whole safari backwards, I promise. We usually encourage viewers to keep a bird list of all of the different birds they see, but we've also started encouraging a tracking scrapbook. So, hey, this female is just behaving so interestingly. Oh. I don't know what all of that is about. Now, Brian B, you were wondering if a giraffe will alarm call if there are lions nearby or if they'll just chase them away. And the answer is they'll sometimes breathe out very hard through their noses. Oh, these giraffes are giving me the runaround. And they will, but generally no, they will not alarm call. And most of the time they will avoid chasing the lions away, although I have seen giraffe chase lions on several occasions. Okay. Since our giraffe have now decided to come all the way back here, a very warm welcome to the Parkway Elementary School and the classes of Mrs. Marla and Mrs. Wagner. Hello and welcome to our live safari. What you are watching is happening right here in the middle of a game reserve in South Africa. And after we're finished here, we're going to get your teachers to show you exactly where you're watching on a map. Now, my name is Jamie, and it's my job to drive the car and to show you the different animals. Oh, and before they disappear, we better go back to them. Look at that. We have one of the tallest animals, in fact, the tallest animal in all the world, and you're so lucky because they're playing games. Look at them run. Hardly ever get to see that. Giraffe racing through the trees. Should we try and catch up to them? I think we should try and catch up with them. Now, Bryce, while we try and catch up with our giraffe, you were wondering what giraffes eat, and the answer is leaves. Bryce, they eat lots and lots and lots of leaves, and with their tall neck, with their long necks, they can reach right up above where most other animals can reach up to feed. Even the only thing that can eat leaves as high as a giraffe is an elephant. So that is what giraffes eat, and sometimes, it's really strange, Bryce, but sometimes a giraffe will even chew on bones. They chew on bones to get the vitamins that they need. They're going to come running right across in front of us. Two boys and a girl, look at them run. Now, I'm sure some of you are really, really good at running, but I promise you, even at running at your absolute fastest, you wouldn't be able to keep up with the long, long legs of a giraffe. Look at them go. Three of them.
Go, we found a buffalo. So the bush's big version of a cow. We're going to try to get a bit closer to him now. Just moving off behind the bush there. You can see there's some little birds riding on him. Oh, he's looking back at us. Nice old buffalo bull. There we go, we're going to move forward a little bit. And beautiful afternoon light coming through. It's very strange weather we've been having today. But I want to welcome all our kids to the drive. My name is Brent, and VM's my cameraman, and we're going to be taking you on an adventure in the African bush. So send us lots of questions, and we'll try to answer them as best as we can. So let's get going and see what else is out there. See if we can catch up with that big buffalo first, who had the hitchhikers on him. Now, those hitchhikers are oxpeckers. They're birds that eat ticks and other bugs that live on the buffalo. So they're there to help him. There he is. Walking through the bush. We're going to try and get opposite them now. We're going to walk out to the open on the other side of those bushes. So, buffaloes normally live in big herds when they're younger. When the bulls get old, so this is a bull, a male, when they get old, they start becoming more solitary, or they live in little bachelor groups. There we go, they're the hitchhikers, red-billed oxpeckers. Now, he's probably around 12 or 13 years old. And buffalo don't really live much longer than about 15 in the wild. So he's an old boy. He's going to move away from where we are at the moment. He's going to move up to the high ground where it's a bit warmer. And there we go. And let him head off. He's going to find a nice spot up on the hill where it's a little bit warmer to have a snooze. And Josiah is wondering, is there a chance that we might see lions today? Josiah, there's always a chance. Unfortunately, there were no lions in our area this morning, but that doesn't mean they might not come back now. So what we can do is go have a look. The last place I saw a lion, see if we can find any tracks around there. There were two young male lions to the west. So let's go see. We'll make our way up there. Hopefully we can find a track, or even better, find the cat that made the track. Very excited to have all you guys with us, and what a nice way to spend a school lesson, coming to learn about the African bush. Welcome to Mrs. Gillespie, who's also joined the live African safari. What we're going to do now is try and find some elephants and lions for Josiah. But I think we've got a better chance of finding elephants today. The lions were to the north of our property. But I'll be keeping an ear on my game drive radio. So this allows me to talk to all the other cars out in safari. So if they find a lion, and we will definitely see if we can get there to show it. Remember, guys, you can ask me questions about the African bush. So send me questions. I'd love to hear from all of you. So while we keep looking for those elephants and hopefully a lion or two, let's go back to Jamie and the giraffe.
While Brent goes off looking for elephants and lions, I've managed to, after driving very fast, catch up with my crazy giraffe that are behaving very strangely. They've been chasing each other round and round in circles. And they're playing. They're actually playing. That's what they're doing. They're having a wonderful time. Look at her bending her neck right down. Having a good sniff at something close to the ground. Now, have you all got your safari eyes ready? Because there's all kinds of things that you can spot out here. And as we look at this enormous animal with her long neck there, look, do you see it? Do you see the little bird at the bottom there? There he goes, he flew off, and he's going to fly back up again. That's called a fork-tailed drongo, and they spend lots of time with animals like giraffe, because as giraffe walk, they scare away lots of insects that the little bird can then pluck out of the sky and catch and have for his dinner. So that's why he's here. Now, Ethan, you were wondering about how tall a giraffe is. They're absolutely amazing animals, Ethan, and I know it's difficult because you're looking through the eyes of a camera, but a giraffe at the top of her head is probably close to about 5 meters, which is 15 feet high. Now let's see what she decides to do, because have a look at that bush that she's standing next to. You see the guari tree? Okay, you can sort of see how tall she is next to that tree. If and only if she decides to walk away now, then I will go and stand next to that tree so that you get a sense of just how big a giraffe really is. But I don't want to scare her away, so I don't want to get out of the car right now because they're scared of people. They're very happy to see the car, but they're scared of people walking about on foot. Oh, look at this, amazing. Look at her bending right down to sniff the ground. Now that is how a giraffe drinks, but in this case they're sniffing at something. They've got really, really good senses of smell. So they've smelt something interesting. Here's the boy on the right, the girl on the left. Now this is a perfect giraffe home. Kyra, you were wondering where do giraffes live and why do they like living there? Well, I say this is perfect for a giraffe because there's lots of trees for them to eat and also lots of trees for them to hide behind if they need to or if they feel like they're scared. But a giraffe can live in lots and lots of different places in Africa. And that's because they don't need to drink as often as some of the other animals, which means they can even live in desert. As long as they can find a place to go and feed on some leaves, maybe a little oasis with some nice trees, a riverbed. They can even live there. But we're in the savannah, what we call bushveld. That is where we are now. Now, doesn't he have beautiful eyelashes on the ends of his eyelids? Those are to protect his eyes because a giraffe will even eat thorn trees. So even with really super sharp, spiky thorns, that doesn't bother a giraffe. He'll happily stick his head right in there and wrap his very strong tongue around the leaves and eat those leaves, even just ignoring the thorns, because his mouth is very tough. Now, giraffes are really clever. You were wondering, Jakari, if there are any plants that a giraffe can't eat that are poisonous. And the answer is yes, but I haven't seen any here. And generally, animals are really clever. Their instincts tell them what they can eat and what they can't eat. And of course, they'll also learn from their mothers as they grow older. And there's a type of plant that some giraffe can eat. You don't really find it too much here, but in other parts of South Africa, you might find it. And what that does, instead of poisoning the giraffe, it actually makes their toenails or their hooves grow really, really fast, and they start to curl upwards like they're wearing a really silly shoe. And that might seem really funny, but what that does is it means that they can't run away from predators. Now, a giraffe doesn't have many things that hunt it, but a big pride of lions would be big enough and fast enough and strong enough to actually hunt and catch a giraffe. We had a little bit of a mad sprint while they were playing with each other and chasing each other around. Jacobin, you were wondering how long a giraffe can run for before it gets tired. And the answer is because they're such big, heavy animals, they can't actually run for too long. They're probably between 5 and 10 minutes at their top speed before they get exhausted and they start to get too hot and they have to stop running and slow down. They can't run for very long, just like cheetah and lions. Cheetah and lions also get really tired very quickly. Now, how many of you have heard of pronghorns? Pronghorn antelope is an animal that can run for a really long time without getting tired. But most of the time, a giraffe is big enough that it doesn't need to run. Mari, you were wondering, would a giraffe ever chase a lion? And I have seen a giraffe chase a lion before, but it was just one female lion, so one lioness all on her own. And obviously the giraffe felt brave enough, and it was a female, so she might have been protecting a baby. So she did go and chase the lion away. But that doesn't often happen. Most of the time, a giraffe would rather move away from a lion than try and pick a fight with it. But if they are attacked, they can kick very strongly, powerfully. Now, you're looking at the boy giraffe, and Jackson and Jero, you were wondering, what are those funny things at the top of the giraffe's head? Oh, I think he was a bit insulted there. Sorry, boy, I wasn't calling you funny looking, although you are a bit funny looking. Those things on the top of his head are called ossicones, but it's basically like a giraffe's horns. Like a horn, like the antlers that your deer have, except that they are solid bone and they stay there throughout a giraffe's life. And for this male giraffe, he's going to use them for, when he's big enough, he's still quite young, but when he's big enough, he will use them for fighting other male giraffe. And what he'll do is he will swing his neck down and around and hit the other giraffe with them. Basically, they stand side to side with their heads facing each other's bottoms, and then they swing their heads round, kind of like, I can't really show you because I don't have anyone to headbutt, and I don't really want to headbutt Dave. Dave, by the way, is the man who is operating the camera. You'll hardly ever get to see him because he's a little bit camera shy, but if you ask nicely, he might give you a thumbs up. Yes, go ahead, Dave. There you go. So a giraffe fights using the ossicones on the top of the head, and they swing and hit each other. Now, Jero, you are absolutely right. Giraffes do have purple tongues. It is absolutely true. So should we try and find the giraffe and see if we can get them to stick their tongues out for us? Yes, let's try. But you've all got to join in, otherwise I'm going to feel very silly. Because yes, giraffes do have purple tongues. So everybody practice. Let's start practicing pulling tongues at giraffe. It's a bit rude, but we're going to try and see if they won't pull their tongues back at us. I don't think they're going to. Oh, they're so far away now. They might not see me pulling faces at them. Oh, sorry, guys. It's a bit too late to pull faces at giraffe. They're watching us. Let's try. Okay, everybody on three. One, two, three. Tongues out. Nope. No reaction. So giraffes have purple tongues, and they have purple tongues for a really, really good reason. It's because, you know how I was telling you that they can eat thorn trees without cutting their mouths or making them sore? If we had to try and eat what a giraffe eats, we would be so sore. Our mouths would be bleeding. But the giraffe's skin, you know how some of you must have freckles just like me? See the freckles? Hands up if you've got freckles on your skin from spending a lot of time in the sun. Maybe haven't put enough sunblock on. So this stuff that makes a freckle is called melanin. And the giraffe have it in their mouths because it actually makes their tongue and the inside of their cheeks really strong so that the thorns don't cut them. So you're absolutely right. I'd love to hear where you found out that a giraffe has purple tongues. Oh, a lot of the time the giraffe are really, really alert. So so they probably saw us all sticking our tongues out at them. Kimera, you were wondering, is a giraffe really good at being alert? Do they have good listening skills? And yes, absolutely. Their sense of smell and their sense of hearing is absolutely incredible. They can hear sounds that we can't even imagine are happening. Now, as human beings, our hearing and our sense of smell, even if you've got really good hearing and you work hard at listening, our hearing is not nearly as good as other animals. So how many of you have pet dogs or cats at home? You know how impossible it is to sneak up on your pet dog or your pet cat? They always hear you coming. Even if you try, and you can go home and you can try, don't scare them, but go home and see if you can't sneak up on your dog or your cat. And I promise you, they will know that you are there, no matter how quiet you think you're being. And that comes from a time long, long ago when dogs and cats were wild and they had to listen like that, just like a giraffe do. Now, it's getting quite late and quite dark. So I'm going to go and find one of my favorite animals, and while I do, let's find out how Mr. Brent Leo Smith is doing.
So the elephants are proving to be a little bit difficult. There was a massive herd around here about an hour and a half ago, and they just seemed to have disappeared. So what we're trying to do now is we're looping around to see if they've come out of the bush and onto one of the roads. So we are still looking for elephants. Now, you can see the sign of elephants everywhere. They're the ones who push down the trees, and you can see there's elephant poop all over the place. Now we just got to find the elephant. Oh, there's an impala. A male impala. Very pretty antelope. It's the most common antelope we get here. It's actually the most common antelope in Africa, south of the Sahara Desert, the impala. And that's a male, and you can see he's rubbing his face on a little bush there. What he's actually doing is scent marking. He's got little glands under his eyes that he uses to mark his territory with. So an adult male impala. Hey, mister. There's another rub. Now, one of the reasons the impala is such a successful animal is because it eats both grass and leaves, so it's a grazer and a browser. Mrs. Sky would like to know, why is he alone? Well, at the moment it's rutting season, so they're competing over females, and he's the unlucky guy with no girlfriend, so he's been pushed away from the groups of females by bigger, stronger males. Just see, there's been elephants everywhere, sign of them everywhere. Now we just gotta catch up with them. Seem to be getting the best of us, but hopefully we'll find them shortly. No tracks of them coming this way, so maybe they went that way. While we look for elephants and anything else we might find out here in the bush, I'll tell you a little story, an African folklore. So it's a traditional African story about elephants. So the Who was it now? I'm going to remember now carefully. Ah, the creator. What's the creator? Oh, sorry, I'm a bit rusty on some of my folk stories. It was the creator. And was having... No, it was the rain. The rain was having an argument with the elephant. And the elephant was a very boastful creature. It said, look how big and amazing, how strong I am. I can lift things. And rain said, well, I'm bigger and stronger and better than you. And elephant denied this, said he would beat rain up. He was much better. So to punish elephant for his boastfulness and being very, very arrogant, the rain went away. And as soon as all the water holes and rivers started to dry up, all the other animals came to have to beg elephant to please apologize to the rain so it will come back. And eventually, after many animals had died, elephant apologized to rain, saying that rain was greater and more powerful than elephant, because without rain, there would be nothing. And that is a San folklore. The San are sometimes referred to as the Bushmen, an indigenous tribe of Africa that lives mostly in the Kalahari Desert these days. Now, with it being very windy, it even makes it harder to find elephants, because how we normally find elephants is we hear them breaking branches, trumpeting, making lots of noise. Hi, Sean. Sean would like to know, why do our plants look so dry here? Well, Sean, we are having a drought at the moment. As well as that, we are going into our dry season. So it is the dry time of the year for us, even though we did have a little bit of rain today. And so we are going into the dry season. It is only going to get drier. And by the end of October, there's probably barely going to be a blade of grass. And most of these trees won't have any leaves, but ones like this will. This is an evergreen tree we get here called the buffalo thorn, or the Vachabiki bos. Now, that's an Afrikaans name for it, a wait-a-bit bush. Now, the reason it's called a wait-a-bit bush is because it's got these incredibly sharp thorns, and one side is straight and one side is hooked. There we go. There's one of those nasty hooked ones. Now, if you get stuck in this, it is very painful, and you have to wait a bit to extract yourself from the bush. But Sean was wondering, what is our most common plant here? And that is the red bush willow. And for those of you not sure what Afrikaans is, it is a language spoken in South Africa. And I will find you a red bush willow shortly. That is the most common plant we get out here. There's some red bush willows. Coming up on the left is not too big a red bush willow, but a medium-sized red bush willow. There we go. And you can see it's starting to turn. The leaves are starting to change color as we head into winter. That is the red bush willow. And it's called a red bush willow, not because it's red on the outside, but the wood is a very nice, deep red color. So the red bush willow. You can see the sun is setting and a little bit of light creeping below the clouds. Isn't that beautiful? Continue on our search for the African elephant. Now, all animals have a scientific name. And what the reason for this is because people speak so many different languages. So if I want to say elephant in Shangaan, which is the local language around here, it's Ndlopf. If I wanted to say it in Swahili, it's Tembo. I wanted to say it in
German. Do you know German, Wim?
Nope.
Trying to think.
I think it's just an Olifant.
So there's lots of different names. So how people around the world are able to talk about or write about the same species without being confused is a scientific name. And the elephant's scientific name is Loxodonta africana. And it's a very good scientific name because it tells you a lot about the animal. So it's originally Latin, loxa. It means long, and donta, denta, dentist, teeth. It means long tooth or teeth of Africa. Except the long teeth of Africa is a long tooth of Africa. Yay! There we go. There's an African elephant, and there's his long tooth. Now, this looks like a young bull, probably around 20 years old, 22 maybe. See that wonderful long proboscis, this trunk. Now, it's like a hand for the elephant. He can use it to pick up things, to break things. A very useful appendage. There we go. See how he's picking up some grass to eat there. And he'll wrap it with his trunk. So Josiah is wondering what is the heaviest animal we've ever seen. And it is an elephant, Josiah, not this particular one. This one isn't too big. He's not fully grown yet. The biggest elephants around here can weigh up to about 6 tons, which is 6,000 kilograms. Now they're also the biggest. Isaiah is wondering what, or if we can see his tusks. There is tusks, those white teeth sticking out of his mouth. Now, and Isaiah is also wondering what are they made from. They are made from ivory, which is basically enamel, which is the same as his teeth. But it's a very, very fine-grained enamel. So they can be incredibly tall, over 14 foot tall. And they can weigh up to 14,000 pounds. So there we go. I know we use meters and kilograms here, but you guys use pounds and feet. So up to about 14 foot tall and can weigh 12,000 pounds. Sounds like there are a few other elephants around. So this guy is a young boy. So he normally hangs on the edge of the bigger groups that are full of the mommies and babies because he's a bit naughty. So the females try to keep these young males on the edge of the breeding herds and not let them cause havoc inside the bigger breeding herds. So we're gonna see if we can find the rest of the elephants. While we do that, Jamie is with one of her favorite animals.
Okay, so hands up if you want to see my favorite predator. We want to see Jamie's absolute favorite predator, one of my favorite animals, and I guess it's kind of going to surprise you. But we have to be really, really quiet because we've arrived at their home and we've arrived here at dinner time. So, let's have a look here. Dave's going to show you. Everybody nice and quiet now. Look who we have found. This is a spotted hyena and her two babies. And right now, they're having dinner. They're sucking from her milk. Now, how many of you have seen The Lion King? I'm sure lots and lots of you have seen it. Now, in The Lion King, the hyenas are the bad guys. They're the horrible animals that basically were the servants to Scar, who was the mastermind. But in real life, spotted hyenas are one of the most amazing animals out here. And I don't want to speak too loudly, because one of the babies, there's actually two there, I don't know if you can see the little ear at the back, is fast asleep. It's gone to sleep feeding from mom. Believe it or not, hyenas are a crucial part of the ecosystem. They fill a very important function. So once the lion pride has finished feeding from whatever animal they've happened to have eaten, they usually leave lots of scraps lying about, and the hyenas act like the cleaners up of the world out here. So they'll go and they'll eat whatever's left. And that's really good because it means that diseases don't spread. Oh, look how cute they are. They're so fluffy. And we've got to know, we've seen these little cubs grow up since they were just only a few weeks old. They were born around the end of December, the beginning of January. Oh, fighting over access to milk there. Hello. You're going to climb on top of mom now. Hello, little mischiefs. Hyenas are also really good at hunting. They're actually better at hunting in places. Oh, they're those big bone-crushing teeth. They're actually even better at hunting than lions and leopards are. That's because they don't get tired very easily. Oh, they're squeaking. Hold on, let me be quiet. Little squeaking sounds. Now here's another amazing fact about spotted hyenas. The females, an adult female is much, much bigger than an adult male. And they basically have a queen, and you're looking at the queen of this hyena clan. She is the leader of this group. And there's probably, as far as we know, there's probably close to 15 different spotted hyenas, maybe even more, in this group. And she is the leader of all of them. And I call her Madam. She's got a very, very round belly, and as a result, she's giving her cubs lots of milk tonight. The two of you were wondering how long a hyena can go without eating. And the answer is, if they absolutely have to, probably close to 3 weeks for an adult hyena. But they usually eat every couple of days. They'll find something to eat. But the little cubs need to eat far more often, just like children do. Adults can go quite a long time if they have to without food, but children need food every day, and hyena cubs are no different. Oh, she's tired. Big stretch. Hello, gorgeous. Dinner time is over, and she's decided to leave the cubs, grooming each other. Probably a brother and a sister, showing just how tight that bond is between siblings. And when they grow up, hard to imagine, but when they grow up, they're going to be fearsome predators. Chimera, you're wondering how fast can a hyena run? Between 50 and 60 miles per hour. And they can probably maintain a speed of about 50 miles per hour for close to half an hour. So they're very fast, but they also have excellent stamina. They're like long-distance runners. Oh, somebody's curious. Come say hello. Sometimes they even come right up to the vehicle. Now you see how much the wind is blowing? That's actually making them quite nervous. That's why they're not feeling brave today. Oh, and they've gone into their holes. The we're going to try and go around the other side. Now, Jashawn, you were wondering what is a hyena's prey? And the answer to that is almost anything. They're quite big, stocky, strong animals. So usually a hyena will hunt something like a zebra or a wildebeest or a kudu. But they have been recorded to hunt buffalo when they have to. And a buffalo is a really big animal. You saw one with Brent earlier. A buffalo is close to nearly 2,000 pounds. A hyena can hunt them if they need to. They're not really fast enough, though, or stealthy enough for some of the smaller antelope. So if they do hunt, they hunt big things. Usually zebra foals or wildebeest calves. Okay, let's try sneaking around the other side of the hyena home. This is their house. This is their house. They live in this termite mound with lots of different doors in and out. Isaac, you were wondering, why does a hyena have spots? And it's a really good question, because they're not an animal that really uses the spots to hide away. They're not like a leopard that uses spots for camouflage. The answer is, I don't really know. I don't know the answer to why hyenas have spots. Maybe there was a time when they did used to use the spots for camouflage and sneak up and hunt their prey. Oh dear. Nobody's home on this side. This is the back door of the den. They've got a front door and a back door, and then they've got a kitchen door somewhere around there, but it doesn't look as though they've come through this side. And I think because it is so windy, they've decided that they want to go to bed, especially because hyena cubs are very clever. When their mom goes away, they know that it's too dangerous for them to be outside. And so what they do is they actually run into the tunnels. And the tunnels are so small that even their own mom can't go in there with them. So it's small enough to keep them safe and away from any danger, especially things like lions. And as it starts to get dark, the leopards and the lions out here are going to start stretching and waking up and going out hunting. I think that's why our little hyena cubs have gone to bed. Let's try one more time. We'll go a bit further forward, but I think that's the last view. We're so lucky we got to see them before they went to bed. No, I think everybody's gone. Now, Savia, first of all, you were wondering, are hyenas' homes underground? And only for the babies. So I said to you that the tunnels are really, really small. So it's only the babies that can live there. When they're grown up, the grown-up hyenas, they live outside. And they quite happily will just go sleep underneath a bush or somewhere else like that. So they're quite safe there when they're an adult. But when they're a baby and there's lots of dangers out here, and they try and hide away underground. Oh, hello. Stop here, look who's coming. There's their mom, she's coming back. We might get lucky, she's gonna walk right past us. See, she's not scared of us at all. Let's just see which way she decides to go. Now, madam is one of the biggest hyena I have ever seen. And Savia, you also wanted to know how tall a hyena is. Which side is she going to go? Is she going to come this side? I think she's looking for her babies again. She's calling them. I'm just going to be quiet so you can hear. Can you hear that low growl? She stopped, which means I can reposition. Good. Oh, that's probably about as good a view as we're going to get of her, actually. How's your view there, Dave? Okay. Sean, sorry, Savvy, I haven't forgotten about you wanting to know how tall a hyena is, and I'm going to show you in a moment up against my own leg. Now, just Sean, you were wondering, can a hyena swim? And the answer is yes, they can. Hyenas can swim. Actually, almost every animal out here can swim. She's growling again. Let's listen. I know it's windy, so you have to listen carefully. She has stopped now. And it's very windy. So what she's doing, I'm going to make the sound for you so you can imagine what she was doing. She's making a deep sound that goes, ooh, ooh. And that's her calling her babies. Hyenas can make lots and lots of different sounds, but that's the special sound that she only makes when she's talking to her little ones. Because it's cold and windy today, we're not getting to see the cubs playing around like they usually do. But Bryce, yes, hyenas do play just like dogs, like puppies. And on a nice day, we watch them climbing all over this termite mound, running up and down, chewing on sticks, chewing on bits of bone, chewing on each other, and sometimes even chewing on my tires, which isn't entirely allowed, and I said, then I have to just give them a stern talking to. They get very curious and they want to come and nibble on my tires. But they do play like puppies, but it's important to remember that hyenas are not dogs. Hyenas are not dogs and they're not cats. They're actually a completely separate type of animal. So we tend to think of them because they kind of look like dogs, don't they? With those big teeth and those paws and those faces, they do sort of look like dogs, but they're not dogs. Totally different type of animal. And yes, Amaya, you're absolutely right. They do have such big ears. And so that they can hear all kinds of things in the bush. Most importantly, it's so that they can hear other hyena. Because one of the reasons that hyena have been so successful is actually because they're group animals. There's lots and lots of them together, working in a group and defending a territory. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever heard or know what a hyena call sounds like. That, ooh, I don't want to do it too loudly because I don't want to disturb her. Ooh, that's what a hyena sounds like. And that sound can carry many, many miles. And that's why they have such big ears, because it makes the sounds even clearer to them. She's so silly. Look at how she's lying. That can't be very comfortable. Now, hyenas are amazing because they have evolved alongside human beings and they're not scary at all. They're of no threat. They're actually really scared of us. But there are some animals that are much bigger and much scarier than we are. Mr. Lespie, you were wondering, how do we protect ourselves on safari? And the answer is, the biggest way that you can protect yourself is time spent in the bush watching the animals. So we always, always looking at what the animal is doing. And it's tiny things. It's their ears, it's their tail, it's the way that they're holding their heads. And through that, we can actually watch and observe, and we can not predict, but we can sort of guess what the animal is feeling. And we can judge our actions based on that. Now, the most important animal to do that with is elephants. All of the other animals where we are, we're so lucky. They are so used to cars that they're not a threat to us in any way. The lions and the leopards are never going to come jumping onto the cars. Now, Sean, you were wondering if a hyena can climb. Not very well, Sean. So they can't climb trees like a leopard can. They can sort of climb up the termite mounds, and they can stand quite tall on their back legs when they want to reach up to something. But no, a hyena cannot climb. It is purely a ground-based animal. Well, I really hope that you have enjoyed all of our time spent on safari. It's been wonderful having you all, and I'm going to say a big thank you from myself and also from Dave, who's been bringing you all of these wonderful images. Have a great day at school, kids, and hopefully we get to see you on safari once again. Bye-bye. And on that note, we're going to leave our hyena den since it is a bit dark and quite windy. And I'm going to send you back across to Brent.
It has suddenly got much colder, and I forgot to look for my other mitt. So I'm down to one mitt. It's somewhere in my room. I have to go try to find it this evening, because I feel tomorrow morning's going to be a very chilly drive. But so we've decided, we've checked literally the whole of Juma now, and there are no signs of any cats, and those elephants have moved off into a very thick area. And Vim and I had a discussion about where do the most random animals turn up? And we decided that it is Sydney's dam. Salala lions, breakaway lions, Salati lions, Birmingham lions, mostly lions. But we're going to bumble towards there and see if we can find one of these randomly appearing big cats. I'm not a big fan of the cold, although most of you in the Northern Hemisphere would think I was a big softy, because it's probably what you would call a balmy day, the temperature at the moment. I'm guessing it's around 18 degrees Celsius. I'm not sure in Fahrenheit what that is, but maybe high 60s. But for us low-felt dwellers in the African bush, it's pretty darn chilly. Kaji's wondering why Karula barely spends any time on Juma at the moment. Has she changed her home territory? No. But I think with the young cubs and this hyena den growing so quickly, she's moved them to the southern side of her territory. When they're a bit older and probably better at defending or climbing and getting away from hyenas, I think we will see a bit more of them. So I think it's to do with the hyena, where the hyena den is, and the fact that that clan has grown quite a bit recently. So to minimize the risk of hyenas with the cubs, she's moved further south. We are now slowly meandering towards Sydney's. I know Jamie was also nearby there. She was at the hyena den, but we're hoping that there's a maybe a small chance of something at Sydney's waterhole. On the subject of the cold, Janine is wondering what's the coldest it gets. It can drop below 0 Celsius, so I think 30-ish Fahrenheit, but very, very rarely, and I've only ever seen frost in the Sabi Sands once. Normally, I'd say the cold, really cold mornings, we drop down to about 6 or 7 degrees Celsius. But of course, being in an open vehicle, the wind chill does make it feel a lot colder. I suppose, Janine, it's all what you're used to. I mean, they're crazy people who go swimming in swimming Arctic waters, jump into that with a polar bear club. I think those people are absolutely insane. So we're about to arrive at Sydney's waterhole. Fingers crossed. Ooh, that was bad. Take my hand out of the warm place. Really need to find my other mitt. Okay, so here we go. Eyes up, them. Everyone ready? We're gonna stop and do a quick peruse. Maybe those two young male lions might still be about. They definitely didn't cross into Juma or out of Juma. So that means they're still in the north somewhere. So there is a possibility they might have come back down towards Sydney's as it's got cooler. Or while it was raining. What do you think is going to be there, Vim?
Leopards.
Vim says many leopards. Vim says many leopards. I think there's most definitely going to be a hippopotamus. But that's about all I'm willing to commit to. So if we don't see any leopards, it's Vim's fault. It doesn't even look like there's a hippo. Oh dear. Oh dearie, dearie me. No, no, there is a hippo. Is it? A little bit to the... No, there's not even a hippo. Oh dear. And literally, now the deathly silence falls. Wait, there's an animal. It's an elephant. A little an elephant bull. Well, at least there was an animal. As you see, it's getting quiet. And you must always see that. Condensation in the air at the moment.
A visual trunk.
Yes. Has he got an incredibly short trunk? Wow. Wow, look at that.
Sorry about that. It seems as though Brent disappeared off your screen and you caught me right as I was trying to disentangle myself from my vast array of cables and radio mics. And I've got three different radios and three different mic sets, which does sort of add to a little bit of confusion every now and again. I did actually find myself talking to some of the guides the other day on the Game Drive channel, but I thought I was talking to the lovely ladies in Final Control, which resulted in much hilarity. does occasionally occur. My favorite, of course, was Steph answering a viewer question through the Game Drive channel, trying to control a sighting at the same time. And he picked up the Game Drive channel and across to all of the guides in the area was saying, you know, that somebody from Idaho would like to know about the lions. So it does happen, but it's okay. I've disentangled myself and we are heading off into the night. And I feel as though on International Endangered Species Day, or whatever the official term is, I can't remember exactly what the name of today is. It is International Endangered Species Day, I'm right. I feel as though we should just pull a pangolin out of the bag. What do you think, Dave?
Sounds
yes,
good.
Yep. Sounds good. Let's go find a pangolin. Animals that we've seen today are not endangered, for which we are exceptionally grateful. Back across to Brent, who has more signal and is still with his Eddie.
I'm not sure how much of you guys got before he disappeared, but look at this. This poor elephant has the shortest trunk I think I've ever seen. Now, he seems to be doing well. He looks healthy from this distance, but look how he's going to drop his head to drink. And you can see how much water he loses in that initial upward movement. So it is a bit grainy, but it is because it's so dark. But look at this. Now, he's obviously had to learn to adapt to feed with that trunk. Jamie was telling me that they had seen a very short-trunked elephant recently. I wonder if this is the same one. If any of you recognize him as the same short-trunked elephant bull, let me know, please. And you can do that by popping an email to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. And poor boy, but it looks like he is adapted to be able to survive with that terribly short little trunk. Now, how an elephant gets a short trunk like that is quite a sad story. It is almost certainly from a snare. Now, that snare would have been set not for the elephant, but for probably an impala or a kudu, and that elephant's happened to get its nose through that wire, and that's what would have cut that off. We have seen a few other elephants like that, so it's not that doesn't look like a sort of a genetic birth defect. That's definitely a snare wound. But it is getting a bit too dark to see him now, so we're going to move on. Yeah, so while we move on, Genevieve, here, Genevieve in New York, so she's been watching since 2014 and she's would like to know what the dead tree in Sydney's dam is. Sorry about that. So, Genevieve, there's two different trees there. It looks like there's a knobthorn and a leadwood. And the reason they haven't fallen down is because, well, a leadwood can stand for 100 years. Its wood is very resilient. And the knobthorn's got quite a deep root system that goes straight down. So you'll find, and if you went to push it, it would probably be loose in the mud, but there's been nothing sort of pushing on it, so there's been no need for it to fall down. It's probably quite set in the mud at the bottom of Sydney's dam. So there's actually two species. Leadwood add a knobthorn. Retired, of course. Now, let me look. Time to lighten up the darkness with a spotlight. Let's untangle here quickly. There we go. Unfortunately, on these cold, windy nights like this, We don't see many of the smaller nocturnal animals. They're not really out yet. They try and keep a low profile. We might be lucky with civet or white-tailed mongoose, but bush babies and that might stay curled up in their little holes for a little bit longer. Of course, watch, the bush baby will come and prove me completely wrong this evening, but that's the way the bush goes. So while we continue to peruse the open areas around Sandy Patch, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
And it seems as though Brent and I have had a very similar idea. I'm also perusing open areas of the bushveld at night. And the weather has become distinctly ominous. The wind is howling about. The clouds have got thicker and thicker, and I can't decide whether or not it feels like it's about to dump a load of water on our heads, or if it's just going to threaten us gently. I'm not entirely sure. It could go either way at this point. Now, something that I just wanted to bring up again, those of you who were watching earlier while we were with the kids, that giraffe behavior, how fascinating was that? It's the first time I've seen that while I've been working here, that level of playfulness. I've seen giraffe play before. There was something obviously in the scents that were going around. I don't know about you guys, but one of the females did look pregnant to me. So it might be that her hormones were provoking that response from the male. But then they also went and all sniffed in that area, right neck, all leaning down to sniff as well, which was also incredibly fascinating. I'm not going to stay too long with this poor guy. We'll just have a brief look at our little scrub here. Having a jolly good nibble. And our little one. With your huge ears searching about. Not quite an endangered species for our Endangered Species Day, but related to one of the most endangered animals that we get in South Africa, which is, of course, the riverine rock rabbit. One that we don't see here, but nevertheless is a wonderful animal. I've been fortunate enough to see one once. The only rabbit type, or legomorph, let's be specific, because they're not rabbits. The only legomorph that we get here is the scrub hare that we're looking at now. The difference between a hare and a rabbit, this little guy's young will be born precocial, well developed, like little miniature adults, ready to run about and play and hop, skip and jump from the moment that they are born. Whereas with rabbits, their young are born atricial, so quite underdeveloped, usually quite almost completely bald, very small, off with their eyes closed initially, so not ready to go out and about into the big, wide, scary world straight away. That's one of the big differences between rabbits and hares. But yes, back to the giraffe. I got distracted by the scrub hare. Back to the giraffe. I would love to have known what was about there. I had a jolly good look while we were in that sighting as to what it was that they were sniffing, and the only thing I could see was an impala midden, which doesn't make any sense. But maybe there's a female in estrus around that urinated somewhere there or something, I don't know. That behavior was very intriguing, most intriguing to witness, but I don't have an explanation for it. But I'm sure you must all have enjoyed watching that, because very often when we see giraffe, most of the time, not that they're boring, just most of the time they're standing staring at you. So to witness them galloping, as it were, across the plains, just gives you a real idea of the speed and the power of an enormous animal like that. Something that we sometimes overestimate when we see them standing still and far away. And that gentle sloping run of theirs just eats up the ground as they run. I really thought that they were going to lean down and pick up a bone, practicing a bit of osteophagy for the calcium. But nope, your guess is as good as mine as to what was going on there. Earlier on, we stopped at the Crested Barbet, and I mentioned that wind instrument players and didgeridoo players are very good at the circular breathing that the Crested Barbet is an expert at. Raisa, you would like to know, since I do play the flute, whether or not I can do it. And the answer is a resounding no, although not for want of trying. When I was really focused on playing the flute, which is around the end of my high school career, because I did do music as a subject for my final school years. I tried really hard, and I read lots of books and internet articles, and I watched videos about how you do it, and I tried the technique where you breathe in while spitting out water to try and teach yourself that reflex. Nope, that just wasn't happening. It's just not something, and I do wonder whether some people are just more genetically able to do it than others, but I think that might be just an excuse. I did try, though. I never quite mastered that. At some point, the flute will come out. It's just been a matter of... It's been a shame. It's been somewhat neglected since I started my career a good few years ago as a safari guide. And it has been gathering dust, and I haven't felt quite ready to break it out just yet in our fireside chats. Although James, it is a constant bone of contention with James. He mentions it on a pretty much daily basis when he is around. I feel as though at some point, relatively soon, I might be press ganged into it. But we have arrived at the Impala Plains clearing, and true to form, there are about half of the population of the Kruger's Impala shuffling about nervously, poor things. This is a night for antelope and other animals to be a little bit afraid, unfortunately. It's just dim my lights here. I've also got a herd of zebra up ahead. Oh, and there's our crazy giraffe as well. See, I can't spotlight them. Being daytime animals, constant prolonged exposure to bright light. Oh, Dave, you appear to be having something of a rain cover problem there. Sorry, I have to just watch so that I don't have a zebra barrel into me. There you go. Because it's so windy, the rain covers are sort of flapping about with us like we're kind of a giant monstrous bird. But the wind is a scary thing for a lot of the animals out here. It's nights like these. Shame, and they probably thought they were in for a reprieve. Nice full moon, but no such luck. It's going to be dark, cloudy, very little ambient light, a perfect hunting weather for the stealth predators. The lions and the leopards will be having a field day, or a field night, I guess, would be a more accurate description. It will be up to us to untangle the mysteries tomorrow morning. That's wonderful news. Belinda, one of our newest viewers, is watching all the way in Australia and has sent through a thank you message for answering her question. Well, it's an absolute pleasure, Belinda. It is, our live safaris would not be the same without questions coming through from the viewers. They really wouldn't. First of all, you'd have to listen to us prattle on endlessly without having sort of any direction to it. But also, secondly, for me, it's one of the things that I thought I would miss. When I first started doing this job, as wonderful as our cameramen are, please don't get me wrong, Dave, I'm not insulting you in any way, I thought I would miss having guests on the back. And it hasn't been like that at all, because the interaction, and sometimes it's tricky, because with guests that you can see, you can gauge their reaction, you know how they're responding to everything. So the viewer questions and the viewer comments have really given me such a boost in that sense. It is really like having all of you on the back of the vehicle with us. So Belinda, please feel free, as you become addicted to Safari Live, which I have heard is quite a problem, but it's okay because there are plenty of support groups out there within the Safari Live and Wild Earth family. You're not alone. Apparently, I hear tell that these live drives are a little bit addictive, so please feel free to continue to send through any questions and any comments that you might have to make. Apparently, you are on your way. This is wonderful news. Hope you have an incredible time and a wonderful holiday out here. And if you wish for any further advice, or when you do head back and you start to feel cravings, spend a bit of time in the bush, well, our live safaris will always be here. Every day, twice a day. As the wind howls around us, it's one of those relatively, I'm not going to call it miserable, because life is never really miserable when you're out in the bush, but it is chilly, and it does seem to come with the prospect of more rain. Shamel, you were wondering, do I think that there's going to be any more rain this winter? Yes, I do. There's always, in my experience, look, it could be different. I'm the world's worst, as you know, I'm the world's worst weatherman, woman, person. But that being said, in my experience, there's always a little bit of, my hair is in my eyes. There's always a little bit of a drizzle every now and again in the middle of winter. Of course, it is our dry season. So when I say a little bit of drizzle, I really mean just a little bit of drizzle. Not very much at all. But we will probably get a couple more mills as we go on into June and July. It's usually in July, I found. But this has been relatively unexpected. Dave, what is that? I think it might just be a daker. See it walking there. Let's just go that way. Change of plan, we're going that way. Sorry, Dave. I just whipped the spotlight out away. Sorry. I'm going to get into trouble for that in our feedback meetings. I just got a little bit excited, I'm sorry. What have we got here? I see. I'm very sorry. There's some buffalo. They caught me off guard because they were grazing, so their heads are right down low. It was buffalo that we were looking at. Sorry, guys. Oh well. Nothing like a little bit of a spike of adrenaline. All excited. It was perfect civitite, and the eyes were shining back very brightly, like it might have been a nocturnal animal. Oh, suicidal scrub here. Don't do that, buddy. I'm going that way. You stay there. Hold on. Shame. All of the animals trying to get to the open areas as we go into this dark, almost stormy night. It's just better to be in the open and to be able to see whatever threat is trying to sneak up on them. A quiet chuckle because we spoke about the addiction that is the live drives, and Becky Hart has said that she's so addicted that whenever she's working in the come on, rain cover, behave yourself now. This is getting ridiculous.
That's all right.
Smack Dave in the side of the face there. You're right there, Dave.
All good.
Okay. Well done. Very stoic. I haven't... Oh, no. Oh, no. Right. We shall solve this problem while I chat about Becky Hart. And Becky Hart, have you got it wrapped, tucked in there? Okay, perfect. Awesome. Becky says that she sometimes, whilst working in the city or else working in the garden, she thinks that she hears impala alarm calls. You're not alone in that, because sometimes when I go back to, and look, I mean, we're trained to be on this constant high level of alertness and awareness of what's going on around us. But when I go back to Johannesburg to visit my parents, I also find I do exactly the same thing. And there'll be a go-away bird that will go quee in the garden, and I go rushing out before I realize that the chances of finding a leopard in the Johannesburg backyard, relatively unlikely, not impossible, but probably unlikely. It's almost like withdrawal symptoms from being out in the bush. Absolutely is important. Heidi has said it's not important, but today is her first ever Safari Live birthday, 1 year and counting. Well, Heidi, I think that's absolutely wonderful, and I'm so glad that you've been on board with us for a year. I've been here nearly a year, so I'm going to be celebrating my anniversary here relatively soon. I think that's wonderful to hear. Well, as Dave and I head for home and more of Amanda's amazing cooking, I just want to say thank you, Dave, for all of your fantastic camera work, as well as to Rebecca and to Jerry in Final Control, and most importantly, to all of you across the globe joining us and feeding your Safari Live addiction. Have a wonderful day, wherever you are in the world, and we'll catch up with you for the Sunrise Safari. Bye-bye.
Oh, nothing yet, as I said. This windy, cold weather without cat, it's quite troublesome to find nocturnal creatures. But it's very good hunting weather for the big cats. So maybe they'll have some success during the night, and hopefully that success is on Juma. So I've just been listening to the Game Drive radio at the moment. There's two Birmingham boys stalking a herd of buffalo, not too far from Cheetah Cutline, but still inside Torchwood. So fingers crossed, they miss the first time, chase the buffalo into Juma, and then jump on it. But we'll definitely have to go check that area quite carefully in the morning. These dark, windy nights always seem a bit airy. Barely see a thing. So normally there's a little bit of ambient light around from the stars or the moon, but if we had to turn off now all our lights, it would literally be pitch black. And with this howling wind, and it's at moments like that when you realize how vulnerable we are as human beings at night. We are deaf, we are blind. Very interesting, and that's why we want to go home when it gets dark. It's actually an instinctive response from when we lived on the African savannas to protect ourselves from the lions and other creatures of the dark. Very windy. Not even any little nocturnal creature. I'm just checking for that Verroes eagle owl who was around here the other night, but no such luck. Well, Elizabeth says she watches. Makes all her clients who come to her salon watch the safari with her. They make her start early. I think that's an excellent idea, Elizabeth. The more we spread the Safari Live word, the more people will get to enjoy this incredible experience out in the African bushveld. Not even the hyenas meandering around at the moment. Maybe they're also deciding it's a bit too chilly to do anything. Oh, scrub here. We're not going to put a light on him there. You leave the light, bright lights on them too much. It does affect their eyesight slightly. Oh, that was close. These Land Rover doors. One of these days, I'm actually going to fall out when I'm leaning against the door, chatting away. And Vim, I'm sure, hopes he'll be the one to film that. Maybe our luck will hold and we'll find a white-tailed mongoose on this dark night out on quarantine, or an African civet. There is always that chance. Hello, Yvonne in Sweden. Yvonne said she's so addicted. She watches miles and miles of dusty road just to see what's around the next corner. And that is the joy of this. You never know what's around the next corner. We could turn the corner and there could be a porcupine in front of us. There could be a honey badger. There could be a leopard. But it is an amazing thing, and I couldn't imagine being anywhere else but in the bush. Take one last gander. See if anything's at the fireside chat. Spot nothing. Oh. Zebra and wildebeest. So I've turned off my light not to blind the zebra and wildebeest. And I'm keeping my spotlight shining straight in the air so I can just see where I'm going. And past them. So Frank's saying we only ever really see elephants like that lying down like they did at the beginning of the safari when they're in groups. If they were did it by themselves, it might be a chance for the lions to get them. So the big bulls will lie down like that, but up against a termite mound or a tree. But the little ones do it more often and almost always in company of their mother, so it is safer. So it's unlikely that you're going to find, well, a baby elephant that's going to survive if it's all by itself lying down in the middle of the bush. It probably means there's something very wrong with it. It's ill or been abandoned or malnourished. Just listening to the Game Drum radio, there's quite a drama playing out. I'm just waiting to hear. Those lions are stalking up to the buffalo. And let's fingers crossed they chase them towards Juma. Unfortunately, nothing out on the vast open plains of the quarantine clearings. And we are heading towards the end
of the safari. And it's been a chilly one, but there's been hyenas and elephants. And hopefully we're going to have some lions and leopards in the morning. It'll be very interesting to see if those Birminghams do manage to catch a buffalo and chase it through to us. So if you want to know more about the Birminghams and the buffalo, join us for the Sunrise Safari.